previously in Dragon's Maw. Tempered Steel and Powder Keg went back to find the Buffalo Bill's Refractor, that Tempered Steel failed to steal the previous night, only to find out someone had stolen it the next day. In their investigation, it turned out that Cookie Crumble's two assistant cultists skipped town earlier that morning. Coincidence? Powder Keg doesn't think so. Meanwhile, Zenkarn and Chica went on a walk. They came across a pony who had accosted Chica during her earlier scouting, and Zenkarn taught that guy a lesson. Chica was on board right up until Zenkarn was about to do serious bodily harm, and then asked him to stop. It gave her a lot to think about for the rest of the day. Finally, the pony known as Opportunity returned, along with a few guards from Flame Tongue, to collect the debt owed for destroying the bar at the very beginning of their adventure. Once they figured out he was legit and had a reasonable chance of making it back intact, the Mawlers went to the dragon's hoard Blinky had been keeping for them and haggled out the costs, improving the available guns and selling off a few of the precious gold and jewels. Shortly after they left, self-appointed Sheriff Slinger came by, warning as many ponies as he could that there was a massive wave of fire geckos heading toward the city, and he needed all the help he could get. Now, I know it's been a couple weeks since the last session, so is there anything else I missed that deserves mentioning?
Javolt does not completely remember the last night, so, yeah.
Right, and Javolt's post hit in his hangover doesn't quite remember the entirety of what he did on his binge, so.
Or what he did before his binge, really. He remembers
all of it.
We got to Ribcage, and then I woke up this morning, and there's lots of spots between them.
Well, Javolt's not entirely in touch with reality right now, but that's really no different than most of the time anyway.
Yeah, all right. Wait, so are you just using that to just kind of, like, sidestep the whole angst thing, or what? Ah, well, anyway. Mm-hmm. The town, Slinger is working the town into kind of a small frenzy, warning about the fire geckos coming toward the city.
Okay, how far off will the fire geckos be when the Mawlers get to the edge of town?
They'll probably have just arrived.
So there's no time for...
Are these fire-breathing geckos or skin fire geckos? I forget.
Breathing fire is on the list of abilities, yes.
Well,
Set themselves on fire is my question.
Set themselves on fire?
Depends. Are they fireproof?
I don't think anyone's seen them do that.
Would there be time for Tempered Steel to call up some kind of weather to help deter him or something?
You could do that.
Okay. Calling in a thunderstorm? Well, no, that'd be, like, not direct enough, probably.
Or no kind of weather would be direct enough to have a huge impact in the fight, anyway. Without also, probably causing some collateral damage to the town as well.
Well, you could do a sandstorm wall again.
Yeah, but that still affects, you know, everybody and not just your enemies.
If anything, I'd say...
And there's plenty of people in the town who, just from where you are, looks like they're heading out to fight the geckos as well.
If anything, I'd say rain so that less things catch on fire.
Rainstorm.
That sounds pretty good, yeah.
Pretty good idea.
Yes.
Well, that also means that you can't set things on fire, but you have other methods.
I have other methods. I can cut things up, I can set things on fire.
You can heal things, because you're going to have to heal things.
Okay, so
yeah, you're going to have to heal things.
Durance.
Powder Keg thrives in this scenario, blowing things up.
1d20 plus 13.
To use your weathercrafter via your hammer.
Yes. How good is this?
16.
Oh. Okay, oh, wait, I've got... Wait, that's endurance, and I believe I can roll that twice then.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, that's a 30.
Okay. Your hammer channels sort of energy in the air, and less than a minute later, the clouds have closed in, and it's raining, starting to rain pretty heavily on the town and its surroundings. Or at least the part of town that's closest to the gecko attack. It's like part of the town is starting to get soaking wet, and the other part is still kind of dry. But yeah, it's now raining.
Alrighty. So if anybody else doesn't have anything we need to do, you should probably get to the outskirts of town. Like, now.
Well, aren't they already at the edge of town?
No, you Slinger met you guys at the bar, or general store.
I thought that we were going there while Steel was...
I was just thought it was implicit that we were just going over there. I didn't want to assume.
We left off the last session.
Last time it was a matter of we were heading to the edge of town to help fight him.
Last time was 2 weeks ago, though, so it's fair to reestablish.
That's good to reestablish.
Yep. All right.
We are out of town.
Yeah, we're at the edge of town when that happens.
So by the time it starts to really start pouring down, you've reached the outskirts of town where a bunch of the other capable townsfolk have entered combat against the fire geckos. A total of, like, 6 of them.
That's it?
Really?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
6 fire geckos or 6 town people?
6 fire geckos.
Okay. Now, when we first came into town, weren't there approximately that number and they could handle it fine by themselves? Or are they bigger?
It's like pretty much the same amount. And yeah, the townsfolk look like they could probably handle it themselves.
Is Slinger still with us, or is he gone?
Yes, yeah, Slinger sold us on the idea. I thought Slinger sold us on the idea like there was this huge...
Yeah, like, that's why I'm wondering if there's more
fire gecko army or something.
Sorry, but... Spud, is Slinger still with us, or did he go on to get more people?
He went off to get more ponies, but he arrives like about 20 seconds after you do, and he just kind of flaps above you, just looking down at the ground like, what?
Blotsam flaps up to him and looks around as well. Where are the rest of them?
He kind of looks around, and then he... Let's see. He flies up, further up, and then points somewhere off in the distance, with one hoof kind of over his eyes to shield his eyes, and then he kind of points off toward someplace at the edge of the maw and says, I think they're retreating?
That must mean...
Are they retreating in the direction that we were going to be going?
Seems like it.
I'm not worried
it sounds
about
like they...
they're retreating.
They got whatever
yeah,
they
yeah.
Before yeah, they got what they wanted.
But fire geckos ain't smart.
They are if they're being controlled by something. We should follow them.
You don't
them.
Think the cultists...
I think the dragon. I think Ormar.
But the cultists went to the dragon, so...
Maybe the cultists, I don't know. We need to go after it and find out.
Oh boy. Another dragon, I guess.
Slinger,
we kind of say we shouldn't keep killing those, or... Damn it.
Wasn't I going to build a time rocket out of that dragon?
No.
No, that's Aurelia just kind of chuckles nervously and says, "No, that's silly, Javolt. You were drunk."
That was a joke that you made while drunk.
It was really funny.
Uh-huh. You were really, really drunk at the time.
Many laughs were had.
We all had a really great, great joke about it.
And then we told a lot of jokes about time travel.
Blotsam is flapping up and down anxiously. Guys, reminisce later. Dragon now.
Dragon later. Figure out how to work in the technical curse. Now, I'm honestly amazed that my equipment hasn't shorted out in all this rain. Really good waterproofing.
Yes, very good.
But if I went out into the technology curse, I would be a detriment. This stage of the game. So.
I thought we gave you a melee weapon.
I am mature enough to admit it.
I thought we gave you, like, a knife or a machete or something.
It was brought up, but nothing ever actually happened.
Oh, well, yeah.
Look,
we
mate,
have
I've got
knives.
An extra knife. You can use that, okay?
Mm-hmm. Look. I don't know what's going on, but we're going to have to investigate it.
Let's go! And Tempered Steel is going to hold his hammer out in front of him and charge in the direction that they were going to be going anyway.
Temper, don't charge!
Flotsam was going to ask Slinger if he could if he and the townsfolk could handle the God damn it, Din, the geckos that were already there. And if, yeah.
Actually, after a little while, the geckos kind of quickly fall to the townsfolk who are defending.
So basically, Flotsam's like, hey, Slinger, do you think you guys can handle... Oh, never mind.
What's that? Tim's got to skip out more combat? Yes!
Pretty much.
Oh, good God.
Well, I mean, Tim's will never combat. Tim's doesn't combat? What is combat? No. Combat? No.
No, Tibbs doesn't combat, he tortures.
Experience combat.
Anyway.
Okay.
The fire geckos are on the run.
So, the townsfolk who have put the beat down to the very few geckos that bothered to show up, look up to Slinger as he kind of floats back down to the ground, and a couple of them are... They look very sort of pissed that Slinger, you know, riled them up and put them all to so much trouble for basically nothing. And one of them goes, what? Really? Really, dude?
There were more. They just didn't come in.
Not his fault they didn't show up.
I cannot do Powder Keg's voice tonight. Jesus.
It's been a little while. And Slinger just shakes his head and says, they were coming. A whole, just about every single one of them. And then they just turned around. And the townspeople don't look terribly convinced. Another one of them goes, look, since you frickin' got here, man, you've just been bossing us around, acting like you're some kind of moral center for this town. No one ever wanted you. No one ever needed you. And now you just, what, you think you're a watchful protector, and then you just get us worked up over nothing like this? We don't need you, man.
Hey, again, this isn't his fault. Maybe they were running away from something, or maybe something called them back.
A bunch Flotsam of the townsfolk just start to leave, although a few of them stay.
Flotsam is going to float up in the air and address the remaining townsfolk. We're going to go investigate this and see if there's anything to it, okay?
Slinger nods and says, I'm coming along too. Anyone else? Anyone else want to help us? Put a stop to these attacks once and for all? Of the crowd gathered, most of them stay sort of awkwardly silent for a little bit. And then...
I volunteer as tribute.
And then a few ponies are pushed aside as Joy steps out of the crowd. And she says, why not? I'll come along.
Hooray! The more the merrier!
The merrier the more?
Are you saying this is a joyous occasion? Puns! I'll mute myself now.
It fills me with joy to see Joy here.
Alright, and then...
Wait, that's a cool big boss, right?
You look familiar.
You know, on the subject of that, I'm not going to do that. Nope, never mind.
And then, after she volunteers, like, a whole, like, row of ponies are just bowled over as Mighty Hyde Bill charges out and says, I'm coming, too!
Yes! I mean, excellent.
Gonna put a stop to those damn dragons once and for all.
They're not dragons!
They're not?
They kind of are.
And everyone around him goes, no!
They breathe fire, and... No, they're not really dragons. They're bad dragon clones.
Flotsam flies up in the air and makes a long, loud whistle. Mawlers and Mawler associates, fall out! And then she starts flying off in the direction of the retreating geckos.
Joy.
I believe it's roll out, Flotsam, not fall out.
Joy chuckles and says, well, I think she meant fall in, but I like it. It works.
I suppose.
Says, I'm going to look around to see if I can find... I mean, you gave me a knife, but I'm not...
It's... Yoshi says, let's hope I ain't drunk. Oh, I wouldn't count on it.
A knife. This is a knife.
Look, I'm not used to using knives, is what I'm saying.
Look, I'll teach you.
Yeah, I get it.
It'll be about this time the Tempered Steel realizes that nobody was following after him, and he'll slow down.
You probably shouldn't charge off until, you know, everyone's, you know, got their business in order. You keep doing that.
Tempered Steel is out there all alone with the giant sandworm cubs.
And suddenly Flotsam catches up to him and looks behind. You think we both might be a bit too eager sometimes?
Well, it's worked in the past.
Are the rest of them following?
Doesn't mean it's 100% solution. Powder keg also not a kind of a jerk thing to do.
Powder keg.
Sometimes when people keep arguing about
still talking about
the okay, you two of you are talking at once.
Sorry.
So who wants to go first?
Raise your hand.
Javolt, what was your thing?
What
was your thing?
Yeah, Javolt is going with the group, but he's sort of awkwardly, half-heartedly protesting that he's going to be completely useless, and he's only got a knife, and... Yeah.
Okay. Javolt, think of it like this. You're all about learning new things, right?
That's part of what I'm about.
Right. About learning things. I will teach you how to use a knife. That way you will know more. Isn't that a good thing?
Look, if he doesn't want the knife, I'll use the knife.
I think I can use this knife. I would prefer.
Okay. Can you use the knife, Javolt?
Stab the face of the skull.
You were just complaining about how you couldn't, though.
I'll show.
No, I'm not saying I can't use a knife. I'm saying that. Well, I'm
not very good at it.
Experienced.
Don't worry. I'll teach you a few things. I'll teach you a few things if you want to, Powder.
I, know how to fight with my hooves, okay? I'm good.
Okay.
Flotsam's voice in the background. Learn while you run!
Then yeah, we'll start... is it okay if we start heading out then?
Yep. Slinger and Joy and Bill, join up with your group, and, Slinger says, Alright. Probably gonna have to fight a lot of those geckos to. We're gonna head towards back towards the cave, their nest.
And that's right, slap bang in the middle of voodoo. I mean, tech curse territory,
yeah,
right?
That's we're about to enter machine curse territory. So he puts his he pulls his gun out of its holster and says, "I'm immune, but I'm the only one." So. If any of you rely on any sort of technology or machinery, you might want to at least have it turned off.
Well, Aurelia's immune.
Aurelia grins and brings out her plasma caster as well. It's like, yep.
Flotsam holds up the hoof that has the pit buck on it. Aurelia or Slinger, could either of you make use of this just while we're in the territory? Or should I just turn it off?
Slinger regards it for a moment. Aurelia looks at her arms, which are kind of a bit too thin to comfortably hold the pit buck. Slinger gives you a nod and says, "Yeah, I think I could make use of that if you'll let me."
That okay with the rest of you? Says Flotsam, starting to take it off.
I don't mind. I'm not the one who uses it.
Cool. It's been fitted to me, so it might be a bit tight, but it should still fit. Just play with the thingy, the adjuster there.
All right. Slinger fiddles with the pit buck for a little while. Turns out his, you know, four legs, which are, you know, more like sort of dragon limbs, but still kind of thicker, they actually manage to fit into the pit buck at its current size pretty well.
Cool.
He has to loosen them a bit, but not too much, and he manages to secure the pit buck to his left leg, and he kind of looks around a little surprised, like, oh, so that's what that's like, the eyes forward sparkle thing. That's interesting. It's been a long time since I've had a pit buck.
Long time? So you've had one before?
I left a vault when I was very young.
You were a vault dweller?
Not much of one. I kind of ran, but I'd rather... I'm not looking to get into personal history.
That's fair. Can I just ask a quick question, by the way?
Yes.
I'm afraid since it was a couple of weeks ago, I don't remember. did Flotsam get given a melee weapon? Because I seem to remember that there was a spare knife and a spare sword and possibly something else, but I don't remember for absolutely certain.
I don't know for certain either, but for the sake of you guys being able to fight when necessary, it shouldn't be too hard for any of the group to drum up some extra... Oh yeah, there was an extra sword from Firelight, extra knife from someone.
From Tibbs.
So, I think that covers the two, Javolt and Flotsam, maybe?
We were talking about giving her a bone scythe, but that didn't end up working out.
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah, we were going to do that, but we'd ended up not having time because we had to rush out quickly.
Right. If you find that you're lacking a melee weapon, Joy actually reaches into one of her saddlebags and brings out this little sort of spiked hoof thing.
Ooh!
The spiked hoof covering and says, just in case.
Thank you!
And finds that it seems to be small enough for a filly of your size to use it.
It's my size! Joy gets a hug. A very quick hug since they're still moving, but all the same.
It is a hand-me-down from Snake. Like, baby Snake is thrown out in the wild with that.
Nice.
Alright. So, unless there are any other questions as a group, I assume you all move out.
Yes.
We're moving out.
Dragon Maulers, roll out!
Alright.
Suddenly we're all transformed.
I don't have any wheels.
I made a joke out of character. Don't make it something it's not.
And yeah. So along the way, Firelight will also be giving Javolt pointers on how to use a knife.
Alright. Do I get any knife tech or what?
You can reflavor a couple of your combat talents to if they work with a sort of melee knife interpretation.
I don't know if I can.
Then you can grab a couple of temporary combat talents.
That's what I did. Spud said I could take some temporary talents for powder keg melee only.
I mentioned before that you can come up with a secondary set of 5 combat talents to represent your alternate fighting style.
Because anyone who uses tech, which is you, me, and Flotsam, is directly screwed by this zone.
Yes, yeah. That's kind of the point. And
I keep meaning to figure out how I'm going to represent that mechanically, and
the idea I suggested was an alternate set of 5 combat talents.
Yeah, it would take me I don't know how long to select those.
Well, it just, I'm not going to... I'll just say it right now. I don't think I'm going to have a whole lot of outright, roll initiative combat in this session, so.
Okay.
Of course we can't. Dinner's in this session.
True. Damn it.
But I also just wasn't looking forward to running a big old fight scene, because that was just going to drag on. And...
drag on.
Yes, yes. Anyway.
Is everybody laughing yet? I'm laughing.
While they're heading along, can Flotsam fly next to... Craggy's riding on her back, by the way, so that he can keep up with everyone. Can she fly alongside Bill?
Yes. Who
Bill?
Is just kind of staring straight ahead, his eye kind of twitching every so often.
Hi, we haven't met. You're the one who was... arm wrestling with Tempered and Javolt, right?
Hoof wrestling, but yeah, he says, just looking straight ahead, very intensely.
Well, if you can take on both of them at the same time, you're pretty badass. I had a question for you, if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure, what?
Why do you call them dragons?
Because I thought they were young dragons. No one told me they were geckos. Joy just kind of... Just kind of laughs and is like, I recall trying to correct you on a couple of occasions, but You were also very drunk at the time.
Oh, do you maybe only call them that when you're drunk?
He just kind of... He breaks away his intense gaze forward and looks at the ground slightly as he walks. Now, I genuinely thought they were dragons.
Huh. Since always?
Yeah, since...
I'm not making fun. I'm just curious.
Since the time I led that big old raid on the cave.
Blotsam actually stops flying and kind of sets herself down and starts walking next to him instead, looking rather pensive. Since you went into the cave, huh?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah, I led a small team to go in there and see what was up. That's where I got the core.
Hmm.
So yeah, it's weird going back now, but, you know, we gotta get that thing.
Well, we gotta stop whatever's happening with it. It's not gonna be good news.
Yeah, Formar's stop all there, this right? nonsense. And he just looks forward again, just completely intensely.
Flotsam is now going to hover over to Chica. Did Chica come with us?
Yeah, she is tagging along, although kind of staying behind, you know, so that she's not, you know, the first one to encounter anything hostile.
Fair. In which case, Flotsam will kind of lift up into the air again and kind of flap in place until she's level with Chica and kind of float over to her. Hey, Chica.
Yeah? You're,
She is in changeling form at the moment, right?
Yes.
Or is she still Golden Dream?
No, she is in changeling form.
Okay. She's like, your changeling magic has to do with mind powers sometimes, right?
She kind of considers it and says, well, yes.
Could you tell if a dragon was having some kind of mental effect on some pony or someone?
If a dragon? Well, I don't know if dragon mind control, you know, mind, mental magic has any sort of similarity to changeling mental magic, because for changeling, it's a matter of love and emotion and perception. For dragons, it might be a sort of different mechanic. I don't know, is the answer for you.
Got some nods. Okay, thanks anyhow.
I have encountered a while back a couple of ponies who were under the effects of the Fool's Gold Curse, but I didn't really take the time to examine them. I just kind of wanted to get away, so...
No, that's okay. I mean, why would you? No, yeah, that's fine. I guess it's just...
I was in disguise at the time, so I couldn't exactly, you know, examine.
Lots of nods, understandingly. I guess it's just the last dragon we came across messed with our minds a lot, and I'm just wondering if Ormar did the same thing to Bill. I don't know.
Well, he definitely looks addled.
The sooner we get to the bottom of this, the better.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Watson fidgets with her spiked hoof thing.
Slinger gestures for the group to kind of come, you know, slow down a bit, and points off to where there's a couple of robots roaming off kind of close by.
Oh my.
The robots...
Jesus, I cannot do powder... I don't know what it is. I can't do my character's voice right now.
Gotta practice that southern. So the robots look like broken and malfunctioned, but also kind of sparking with energy. One of them seems to have this sort of glowing claw-like weapon, and the other this sort of energy gun arm thing. But it looks heavily damaged. And Slinger looks to them and says, if we get the jump on them, we might be able to take them out quickly.
Alright then. I got it. Why can I not do that?
Spend more time practicing and less, you know, complaining about how you're losing the accent.
Yoshi says, quit invading Lapis's mouth, Sarg.
Aurelia raises her hand and says, I'll help with the ambush.
Are we in tech territory now?
Yeah, you're well within machine curse territory now.
Yep.
Blotsam waves at her. At this point, I could probably serve as a distraction and not much else.
Slinger shakes his head. I don't want to put anyone at extra risk if possible, especially if they're being affected by the curse.
Risk.
Joy steps forward. I can help take them down quickly. Bill stomps his hooves and says, just tell me when to charge.
I could probably
I can get through this.
I can probably set up some smoke cover and stuff so we can get closer without them noticing.
Excellent. That sounds good.
Now, I can probably do a few things. Been a while since I just run into melee combat, but...
Well, I'm thinking between mine and Aurelia's guns, Bill's charge, firelight smoke screen, and he kind of looks at Joy and says, whatever she does, Joy rolls her eyes and says, it's CQC, but anyway. I think, I don't know if that'll be enough, but it'll be a good start.
Watson right. just looks over at Zankar and Zombie.
Sounds good.
Damn it, we can't do bombers right now.
Yeah, but zombies are still pretty cool.
Yeah, I suppose.
I'm gonna hang back on this one, but I'll be here if you need me.
Alright. So, Slinger nods and kind of leads you guys over to this kind of big old rock for the group to kind of stage their ambush behind. And then says, alright, Firelight, go.
Alrighty, I'll use pyrotechnics to set up a cloud cover.
And smoke kind of billows out from around the robots, who stop and look very confused. And Slinger says, alright, Necromancer, your name, I forget. The zombies?
Can do. Do-do-do, if I can get Rolls Room to cooperate, which hopefully I can. Zombies. 25!
Alright. The ground beneath the robots breaks apart, and you can definitely hear the telltale sound of zombies rising up, moaning and grabbing for the robots who just start attacking them. But not terribly effectively, because the zombies don't really react to being hit so much, and the zombies just kind of grab on. Slinger motions to Bill and says, alright, you enjoy. Now, just charge in. And Bill lets out this huge "Hurrah!" and just gallops into the fray, just completely slamming into the two robots, like sending them flying up into the air as he just kind of kicks them up with his head and his horns, just Joy rushes in and gets a few strikes in on the one with the cannon arm, and with this sort of chopping motion with her front hoof, just tears off the gun, like, clean off, just breaking through the metal entirely. And then, at the very last, Slinger and Aurelia just come out from behind the rock and just unload, one with his custom pistol and the other with the plasma caster. Aurelia gets a few shots in, doesn't quite completely destroy the robot. Slinger gets a lucky shot at the central processing unit of the other robot and shuts it down. And by that point, Joy finishes off the other robot with a couple of quick, strong kicks. Slinger just kind of looks around and says, all right, I think that's it.
The dust settles, Watson pops up from behind the rock.
All right, then. So what do we do now?
Can we come back this way on the way back so we can harvest them for parts? Blossom's eyes are gleaming.
Yeah.
I don't see why not.
I suppose we can. Whoa.
I would honestly prefer to restore them and make them legal citizens of Ribcage, but...
Now, that one I'm not so sure about. Javolt, do you remember that these are just robots?
Slinger sets down on the ground. And he and Joy seem to be looking at one of the zombies that Zenkarn revived.
God damn it.
You guys want to come look at this?
Blossom floats over. What's up?
I'll go over. Poke it. Seems like a normal zombie to me.
Some of the flesh kind of peels off in an unsettling way to reveal that there seem to be a few machine parts in one of the zombies you just raised.
Well,
I can raise cyborgs now. Fuck yeah. I mean, that's awkward.
Wait, what? Can Flotsam examine this?
Hold on. Can I roll to examine this zombie to see what its cybernetics do?
Yes, actually. The zombie seems to be under Zenkarn's magical control, so it's not doing anything else. The machine parts don't seem to be active at a glance, but yeah, you can roll mechanics to examine it.
Alrighty then. Dr. Javolt moves over and looks at it. Let me see what he... Okay, that's not... There we go. 21 for figuring out what these cybernetics would have done if the zombie were alive.
If the zombie were alive, that's a wonderful phrase. With a 21, it looks like... There's just a couple of implants. One to sort of strengthen one of the legs that seems to have had some kind of tissue damage back when it was alive, and then one to an eye implant of some kind, like just for the left eye.
Hmm.
Huh. There's some reinforcement to the spine as well.
So,
you suppose they died out here?
Can I tell if this was like repairs or just upgrades?
The leg seems to have been kind of more medical in nature, kind of a repair, but the other two were definitely like upgrades. The spine is a complete transplant job.
Wait, I have a question. Does these look like they were put in before or after they died?
Judging by how there was still flesh, little bits of flesh covering them, it seems that it would have been before they died.
Okay.
Right.
Do they look like members of the cult?
They don't seem that way.
Who's making cybernetics?
Do the cybernetics seem like they malfunctioned in any way or just stopped working?
Well, they're definitely not working now.
Hmm. Can I...
They also seem to be, I don't know, quite old. There's lots of... The metal is very rusted and dirty from having spent time in the ground.
Can, Flotsam turns to Zenkarn. Zenkarn, do you know how long, like, can you figure out how long this guy's been in here?
Rate of decay, that kind of thing, but should be able to. Perception roll or necromancy, or arcana roll?
Lacking any sort of, archaeological...
Autopsy!
Yeah, and the autopsy section.
Yeah, you'd probably want to employ some of your necromantic skill to this.
Alright. So good for freaky knowledge on that as well?
Yeah. You're autopsying him, even though he's just standing upright, but yes.
26. Wow, that's terrible.
This body a couple of the bodies you revived were recent. Not this one, and not a couple of the other ones, though. This body is quite old. Like, at least a century old.
Oh.
Hmm.
Just judging almost entirely by the level of decay.
Cool. Relay that information.
Flotsam looks very surprised. Would that put it, I don't recall offhand the Fallout Equestria timeline. That
would have been a century. It wouldn't be.
It's 200 years, I think, is the gap.
Yeah. So okay, it wouldn't be quite post-war, but...
Well, I said at least a century. With with the 26, you aren't able to pinpoint an exact date.
Hmm. I don't know. Does it have any other... Does it have a cutie mark?
No, the section of the body with the cutie mark has rotted away a long time ago.
Damn. I was going to say, given decay, would it still... The fact that it still has flesh, would that just be that it was quite preserved because of being buried underground?
Would have been a little preserved, yeah.
Yeah, usually 100 years, almost all the flesh is gone.
Yeah.
Usually after 100 years, more than the flesh is gone.
Yeah.
It seems that this pony's flesh was a bit more preserved than usual then, and if so, that this pony might be even older than you think.
Woo! I vote we harvest the parts.
Did you say something, Ben?
Yeah, I said, can Tibbs do a pseudo-autopsy to possibly see how old it is?
Sure, although you have slightly less experience trying to identify very old dead things, but...
Right, right. Much more knowledge with recently dead things, but hey, worth a shot. So what would that be? Perception?
Yeah, for you it'd be perception.
Okay. Alright, well, I'm doing 20%. So, like, technically speaking, the only way I could get more than Zenkarn would be a 19 or a 20. So, hey, worth a shot. 25. So,
wow.
One less.
That's pretty close.
That is pretty close, but it's not going to be anymore. All right.
What I can do, however, is does this
hold
thing...
On, hold on, hold on, Tibbs, with a 25, you're just kind of trying to look at this guy with perception and see if you can tell how old this guy might be. You can definitely tell that for a really old corpse, you definitely should be probably a bit more decayed than this, based on mm-hmm. what Zenkarn told you. But looks like not only a lot of the flesh had been sort of, you know, embalmed, preserved in some way, but, you know, there's some kind of residue on him. But it seems like there might be some sort of magical effect as well.
Hmm.
All right. Tibbs is going to relay that in a Tibbs-like fashion. namely...
It's magic might.
No, what he was going to say is, well, the fact there's still skin on this dead body at all, when most things buried in the ground lose their skin after about 6 weeks, says to me there's probably some magic on this thing.
Would make sense. The question is why they'd want to preserve this particular creature's corpse. Does this thing still have a head?
It does.
Cool. Actually, no. It only needs to have a corpse or a skeleton, which it has both. That's cool. Can I use Speak with the Dead in that case? If we've got 10 minutes to work this stuff out? Because it's probably quicker just to ask him directly.
Yeah.
Cool.
You can try. Problem is, the soul might have moved on a long time ago.
Yeah, that's a fair point.
There's a, you know, small statute of limitations.
Oh, well, yeah, understandably. Can't just have me reviving anything.
We need to revive Twilight Sparkle. I know that's not even possible in universe, given what happened.
Pinkie Pie. Well, you probably think that Pinkie Pie.
Luna, revive Luna.
Yeah, you'd have to have the level 4 destiny that allows you just to name a soul and just summon it. Which is ridiculously broken in some cases. Alright, would I be able to examine
don't
the magic?
You have that? Isn't that part of Necromancer? Or?
No, you either get that or you get summon infinite zombies.
Oh, and you did summon infinite zombies.
Well, out of the two, it seemed less dickish to Spud, because otherwise I would be doing stupid shit like
all
Fluttershy.
Fluttershy's not dead, though.
Oh, that's true, yeah.
Well, yeah. Rarity would be an interesting one to bring back, actually, but then
except for some of her fragments.
Some of her soul
escaped,
though.
Yeah, she kind of did things. Anyway, you can examine the magic on this thing.
Cool.
Yeah, if I were DM, I'd rule. There's really nothing you can do to get
Nat 20.
Back.
CMC.
Okay. The body, the zombie body of this cybernetic pony you had dug up from the ground, as you examine the magic and almost immediately find the enchantment's mechanism to dispel it.
What is it, though?
It's, you're not sure, but it seems familiar somehow.
Oh!
Extremely familiar.
That's always nice. Well, Kit, let's...
Not in a necromancy sort of familiar. Familiar in another way.
Oh, God, that's never a good sign. But,
based on, I don't know, it seems to remind you of someone you've been spending a lot of time with.
Helpful. yeah, I can dispel it?
Yeah. Just
sure,
no effort. Just do it.
Boom! And then bam! And the magic is gone.
Is it reminiscent of death?
The body is enveloped in what seems like green flames.
Oh!
And then standing before you is not a cybernetic zombie pony, but a cybernetic zombie black carapace-covered chitinous thing.
I get what you mean now.
Eyes widened.
Chica just dashes forward and just like, what?
That's interesting.
She
dashes over to a couple of the other zombies you brought up from the dead, and after finding the two that are not so recent, her changeling horn glows, and she zaps the two zombies, and they also change into base changeling forms.
Okay. Well, that's cool.
That's, surprising.
Damn. How I wish I... there's no way of finding out. That's the annoying part.
Sheikah just seems shell-shocked at this point.
What the hell are these doing here?
This might be something of a disturbing and ludicrous suggestion, but knowing what little I do of changeling physiology, would it be possible for some memory engrams to have survived within the brain for however long I'm saying maybe, possibly, it might be possible for a live changeling to reach the mind.
Sheikah sighs and shakes her head and says, not unless one of them recorded a memory orb, which I don't see around here, do you? Huh?
I was actually suggesting that their brains might naturally serve as a memory orb for
they've
other
decayed.
Changelings.
They're zombies. They've been dead for over 100 years.
Watson floats up to Chica. Well, we already know that there were hives out here in the moor. Maybe there was one nearby. Maybe we could investigate more after we've taken care of the gecko problem.
She just puts her head in her hooves and says, there was a hive here. I don't know where, but this is what I was looking for.
Javon comes and it might be possible that there is still a hive.
Thought occurred to me, Javolt, but we just found a bunch of ancient dead bodies. There might be survivors, but are they going to be alive? Are they going to be sane?
Why no until we find them?
I haven't met a whole lot of other friendly changelings out here, is the thing. There's not a whole lot of love to spare in the wasteland.
Hugging intensifies.
Well, I guess the big news is the fact that these have been here for a long, long time. So,
cybernetic.
And if they've been cybernetically enhanced, that means they're working with someone, I would assume. So, there might still be some wandering around that, I don't know something about this.
It's too early to tell Zenkarn.
Blotsam is going to look back and forth between Sheikah and Zenkarn, see that Sheikah's obviously freaking out just a little bit, and then just kind of gently lead Sheikah over to Zenkarn. Push Zenkarn into Chica and say, hug.
Hug?
Hug Chica.
Chica lets out a sigh and reluctantly accepts the hug.
Woo! Hugs.
Lots of nods. You have to take care of each other.
Powder Keg just kind of looks at the bodies for a bit and then says, hive, huh? And that just happens to be a network of tunnels being used by some kind of fire geckos. And maybe a dragon in there.
You thinking that
what you're saying is that
tunnels?
The dragon turned the changelings into fire geckos?
No, not at all, Javolt. What I'm saying is that the tunnels that the fire geckos are in and that the dragon may have taken might have been changeling hive at some point, which could explain the ancient dead changelings in the case that a dragon rampaged and decided to steal their home.
But what if it didn't? Because it's a machine dragon, right?
Yeah.
They've got cybernetic enhancements. What if the changelings were working with the dragon for some reason?
Well, there's one way to find all this out.
Yeah.
Keep exploring.
We need to push
Ask
on.
Ask the dragon.
All right.
Flotsam will also float over to Slinger and say, Slinger, mark this location on the pit book if you want to come back here.
Slinger nods and fiddles with the pip buck. How do I do? Oh, there we go. Okay. Yeah, I've set a marker here.
Thank you. Okay, is everyone ready to move out now?
Tibbs is gonna nod.
Chica, you gonna be okay?
Yeah. One thing at a time. I'll be fine.
Lots of nods
she kinda,
and looks
she
entirely sympathetic.
Shakes herself a bit and says, no, really. This was a shock, but part of me suspected, part of me knew that there would be something out here, dead or alive.
All the same, having your suspicions confirmed.
Especially like this.
She trails off. Anyway, let's go.
Yes, let's go. Chica stands still for a while as the rest of the group moves on. Joy actually comes by Chica and kind of gives her a pat on the shoulder before moving on. And then Chica starts to follow as well, taking up the rear again.
Tibbs is going to, for a moment, hang back until he's about the same pace as Chica, and then sort of quietly say to her, normally I wouldn't be asking this because it's a, you know, it's a Javolt theory, but do you think it'd be possible for you to take a Fire Gecko's form?
like I've explained to Zinkarn a couple times now, changing a form that's a fundamentally different size from a pony, that's a little more difficult.
Tibbs will nod at that and go,
Not impossible, but I don't think my level of strength is there yet.
Tibbs is going to nod and go, just figured a sort of hive mind thing I've heard about the changelings would make sense for, as for why those geckos decided to split rather than stay.
Well, like I told Flotsam, this could be some kind of draconic mental influence, but I don't know if there are enough similarities to changeling mental magic influence, so I just don't know.
Guess we'll find out once we pick that dragon's brain.
I guess so.
And with that, Tibbs will continue get back up to the rest of the group.
Although Famine's was quite similar in a number of respects, and supposedly he was using draconic magic. Or maybe it was pony magic, I don't know.
Could be both. Who's to say the dragons didn't pick up something from us and vice versa?
There's that too. There's just too many unknowns, so honestly, I don't expect me to be much more use moving forward.
Continue to think that. I'll hold you in a high respect.
Don't know why you do, but alright. So the group hikes on for a little while longer. This time avoiding encounters up to this point. You can see a couple of geckos and machines roaming far, far off in the distance, but nowhere close enough to notice you. Or, you know, to draw aggro, as it were. And in most of an hour, you reach this sort of, I guess, very large pit leading down to this cave structure below you, this cave entrance. There doesn't seem to be anyone immediately in the entranceway or around it, but Slinger looks down into it and says, "This is the place, right?" And Bill nods vigorously. He says, "Yes, this is it. This is the Fire Gecko Cave, everyone."
All right, then. Finally.
And as you approach the entrance, you hear something very faintly. Roll perception.
Oh, no.
My 5 perception will clearly notice this. Clearly.
Perception.
Actually, I rolled an 18, so 23. Maybe I will notice this.
I got a 17.
I got an 18.
I got a 24.
I got 15.
Surprisingly good rolls.
Powder Keg, and Tempered Steel, and Zenkarn, and Flotsam. You hear, very faintly echoing from somewhere deep within the cave, you hear something like, Get away! And sounds of that nature faintly echoing.
What the? Sounds like somebody's trying to tell something to get away down there.
Tempered Steel's gonna head in that direction.
Well, the only direction you have is forward into the cave.
Oh, okay.
Looks like someone's having trouble in the cave. Well, then whether they're an ally or an enemy, I don't know.
Let's go. We may as well.
Anyone else? Oh, sorry, Zinkarn.
No, you're right.
Slinger, do you know if anyone else came down here?
Well, you said something about the cultists earlier?
Yeah.
If something's fighting something down there, I don't know who or what, but I assume most of the geckos came back here. They went in this direction, and we haven't seen too many more other geckos, so they might all be inside.
Tibbs is going to turn to Zen. Tibbs is going to turn to Zenkarn and go, Tin Cap says it's a trap.
Yeah, I'll take that bet. Do you want me to scout ahead?
Yeah, you got that dreamwalk thing going, so take care of that.
Cool. Someone who, you know, someone carry my corpse so with you guys.
That's people taking against him for where it's not a trap, or which way, how does that work?
Tibbs says 10 caps, it's a trap. Zenkarn's apparently taking 10 caps, that's not a trap.
Yeah, yep. That's how it's going.
I'll take that bet too. Here, double.
Sure, I like taking money from suckers. You're gonna be really mad if it's not a trap.
Zenkarn.
Hmm?
Flotsam is asking if Steel can carry Zenkarn's body.
Bill raises a hoof and says, I can do it too.
Oh, really? I just didn't want to put you out since you're not in our party, but if you're happy to...
You just need to get moving. And if you can scout it out, all the better.
Tempered Steel will put Zenkarn's unconscious buddy on top of Mighty Height Bill.
Alright,
so... I'm okay with this, even though I'm unconscious.
Alright, so Zenkarn and your soul form Dream Stride, you head on in?
Yep. Forward the buffs.
Alright. So Zenkarn, you get the first glimpse of the inside of the cave. There's, just from as you move along, there's really only kind of one winding path down and forward. It twists a couple times, but there's really only one major, pony-sized path you can traverse comfortably. And around, there seem to be, alongside the main tunnel, there are these sort of smaller, gecko-sized tunnels. It's basically a whole warren network thing going on. You go, the path winds, you go your right and then down, then left, and then another left, and then down, and then right. Along the way, you pass by a couple of geckos that are just kind of hanging out in the tunnels, as well as you come to this sort of long stretch that seems to be kind of a narrowing point before the path opens up in some large way. There is a corpse sitting next to the entranceway. It seems in burned cultist robes.
I'm okay with this. I'm just going to be mentally relaying all this back to Flotsam.
Flotsam will in turn quietly relay this to the rest of the group.
And then roll a perception.
Yay, perception. Which is still a 10, so I don't actually have to change its thing. Boom, 23 again.
Hidden in the corpse's barding, sticking out ever so slightly, seems to be some kind of metal square. It looks like a holotape, actually.
I try and grab it for a second before remembering that I can't. God damn you.
Alright, so you move on then?
Yep.
Alright.
Be like, the stuff in the cultist robes, remember to pick that up. And then tell me what it is.
The cultists seem to be guarding this entranceway that opens up into this actually really sort of grand atrium almost, with this bridge spanning kind of a sizable pit. As you cross this length of this open cave section towards the other side, it's actually quite a little bit unnatural how it's been carved out, and there are great great holes in the walls and whatnot, like almost like divots have been carved out, and it almost reminds you of kind of a lordly hall.
Oh boy!
Woo!
Changeling hive theory confirmed.
And you cross over.
Plays in my head.
Cross the great bridge thing. And after following through a few more narrow tunnels, you finally come to this meeting area, this sort of circular cave room thing. That's actually lit up, unlike the rest of the cave at this point. There's a couple of lamps. And inside, you can hear the source of the noise you've been hearing, and it's this cultist unicorn mare, magically wielding the scimitar, just defending herself desperately against a whole swarm of fire geckos, like a huge number of them, just going, ha! Yah! And besides all that, just barely visible past the swarms of geckos, in the very center of the room, there is this silvery stone in the shape of a dragon's scale with draconic writing all over it.
Ah, what a time for me not to be able to use many tongues, god damn it.
And gathered up at the base of that, the dragon stone that you recognize, is a whole, pile of what looks like technological junk. Just all manner of bits and baubles that all look like they were parts of some machines or others. And, just this whole almost shrine-like arrangement of, mechanical parts.
Cool. I sent a message to Flotsam. Tell Tibbs he owes me 10 caps.
Tibbs, Senkine says he owes you 10 caps, apparently.
Oh,
no, wait. You owe him 10 caps. Yes.
Ah, well, you win some, you lose some.
So, how's the cultist man doing? Has she actually managed to kill anyone yet?
She's actually... The fire guys are attacking her with a almost, kamikaze abandon, and she's managing to get... She's just through sheer, panicked reflexes, she's been cornered by these things. She's getting killed pretty reliably, but not without getting a scratch here and a fire breath burn there.
Fantastic.
But she's also got a stock of healing potions that she's using quite regularly.
Cool. Because we worked out earlier that I can in fact make zombies without utility talents. Let's go. How many corpses are there?
There seem to be only fire gecko corpses in here.
Aww. Well, how many?
Right now, about 10.
Okay. I want to try and raise all of them, or as many as I physically can.
Have we done this before? Are you using necromancy while you're in Dreamstride?
No, but it just says I lose access to utility talents, not skills.
That's true, but I wonder if it's kind of breaking flavor for you to be able to...
Well, I mean, it depends. If necromancy is basically channeled through a soul, and all I am is a disembodied soul, there's no reason I shouldn't be able to...
I don't think, though, you should... ignore the importance of the body in a necromantic ritual because
I definitely don't,
because there is that element of your body grounding you in this plane and the living world as well.
Also, just want to point out your own necromancy system involves the use of symbols and presumably involves
drawing. If you're going to go pull the manual into canon, in which case I would like to direct you to the zombie section. Where if you can use, a skilled necromancer, or one who's at least used to summoning basic zombies, for the basic zombie ritual, it's basically just a circle, and you imagine you draw the circle around the body, and the circle acts as a focal point. But if you are advanced enough, you can do it by just mentally imagining the circle. I mean, if you don't want me to be able to do it while in soul form, I don't mind, but...
My two cents is the utility talents one is there. Basically say, you can't really use any spells or anything. You are disconnected. You can't really interact with the world around you.
Yeah, that's my take on it. The way
things like what you're trying to do used to be governed is by a utility talent called Magecraft, which would have handled anything like that for magic, and it was too powerful, so we got rid of it for obvious reasons. But it would technically be considered a utility talent kind of use, so...
That's the weird bit, though, because I have summoned zombies without utility talents before.
Yeah.
Without utilizing utility talents. But hey, if it's a no, it's
not while you're in Dreamstride.
Yeah, no, that's cool. I just wanted to check, because I thought it'd be kind of a neat idea. That's cool.
Being able to...
We'll get to solo a cave of fire geckos one day, don't worry.
Figure, though, if you become a master necromancer, you can summon zombies from whatever form you like, I think.
Woohoo!
At level 10.
At level 10.
Which you can bet we're probably done playing by then.
Yeah.
Almost about done, yeah.
Oh, that's cool. In that case, if I can't help, I'll just tell the others to hurry up. I need my body to do things. Hurry up.
Watson's okay, Zenkern wants us to catch up with him now. Shall we pick up the pace? Blossom looks anxious to get going. There's a pony up there who needs help.
Yeah. I'll start going along with Blossom and stuff into the cave. How dark is it?
It's pretty dark in there. There's some sort of bioluminescent lighting in the form of a couple of plants and some stuff on the walls, but it's still very, very dark.
Okay. Would it be okay if I used celestial light to pretty much just make a light source for us?
Oh yeah, you could probably just do that with your, fire magic at this point.
Okay.
But yeah, you can make a light to lead the party by.
Okay.
Unfortunately, due to the narrow nature of the cave, you're kind of stuck in not quite single file, but like 1.5 file at most.
Flotsam is making sure that Zenkarn doesn't fall off of Bill.
No, he's pretty secure. Bill is doing his best to keep himself steady, even on the downward slopes.
Flotsam still worried.
All right, so Zenkarn, do you disable your Dream Stride, or?
I'll disable it when they get to me.
Alright. So who's sort of leading the way on this?
Powder Keg will take up the front, if that's okay.
Alright, that means you'll have Firelight with the light source somewhere behind you.
Yeah, I'll go behind him. And so.
If Firelight's right behind me, the light should radiate out a little ways in front of me anyway.
Alright. You come to a corner, and you hear some movement down the path to your left, and it seems like there are some geckos down the hall, and they are reacting to the light source bouncing around the corner.
Okay.
And they start to come towards it. You're kind of hidden around the corner though.
Are there any large loose rocks sitting about?
Well, I have no idea what it'll do, but it'll probably provide a distraction. Cut the light. Powder Keg throws one of his explosives armed and just to see if it'll catch on fire or do something, just to see if it'll distract them towards another tunnel. Fizzles up or just bursts into flames or does something.
And you want me to kill the light?
Yeah, he said that. He said kill the light. I'm going to do something.
I'll go ahead and turn off my light source.
All right. Powder Keg, you toss the grenade down the cave hall, and instead of exploding when the grenade cooks and fires, it lets out this sort of loud screeching sound, this sort of sonic screech that echoes throughout the whole cave.
That doesn't sound like it should even be physically capable of doing that.
And but the geckos who were at sort of the blast zone, just wince. They cower and they just dive back into some of the side tunnels, just burrowing away.
All right, run like hell, because we're gonna see a lot of things coming towards us.
Then, Carmen, in your dream stride, you see a lot of the geckos are sort of they're farther away, but the echoes still carry a lot of the bouncing of the screech sound waves gets muffled in just the distance and how many bounces it's had to travel, but they do hear it, and they do when the geckos do kind of stop and look a little confused a bit, and the mayor with the sword, who is in the middle of pulling it out of the body of one of the other geckos she's trying to fight, even she stops a little bit and goes, what? Before the fight just resumes as the geckos and her stop being affected.
I roll my eyes and I'm like, oh, here we go.
Well, I had no idea what was going to happen, but I guess that distracted them. So,
we're running?
Not too much. Sure. Yeah, let's run like hell.
Because if they didn't know we were here, they know now.
Alright. So you run and you run and you run, and thankfully you're not bothered too much along the way. Then you notice, you come to the place where you notice the cultist off to the side next to this sort of stone entryway.
Do we notice her, having the trouble with the geckos?
You're not there yet. Do you just keep running?
We head that way. We head there a little cautiously.
Alright, so you enter through the main... into the main
Dave
atrium.
In the other room is saying, take cover. The data core? Oh, never mind.
Someone in the background shouting at you?
Dave sees what we're meant to do, but I can't actually hear him properly.
He's probably talking about, I don't know, the holotape.
You can't listen to the holotape right now.
Yeah, but you can pick it up.
We didn't check the cultists like you did. You didn't tell us to expect.
So you just continue on. You just continue on.
No, he did. He totally did tell us because he was relaying
powder
everything.
Powder keg
yeah,
will grab.
Us grab it.
Powder keg will grab.
You search. You search the body real quick and easily find the holotape. It's this
day for saving our butts.
It's this sort of silvery earth pony under the cultist robes. Looks like he just kind of burned and passed out.
Powder keg is going to, well, don't normally like to do this, but he's going to disrobe the cultist. These might come in handy.
You, take off the cultist robe and, stuff it into your inventory, I guess.
Yep.
Anyway, are we hurrying along?
Yeah, so after that you hurry along, you pass through to the big old atrium that I described before, cross the bridge spanning it, and then walk through, just run through the remaining winding tunnels, and then come into the final sort of shrine room where the mayor that Zenkarn's been watching is still going at it, kind of a bit ragged though, and geckos are still kind of formidable force.
Okay. As soon as I see the large numbers of geckos in the room and the fighting going on, I'm going to yell, everyone close your eyes, and I'm going to use pyrotechnics for fireworks to blind all the geckos.
Ooh. Yeah, you can do that. All the ponies and, you know, sentient creatures in the room close their eyes. And, with your horn glowing, you just summon up this loud and massive and bright just display of color and light and fireworks, which just blinds and confuses the hell out of the geckos. Some of them screech and run into walls, and some of them just stand around gormlessly. But they are all pretty much completely taken aback by your fireworks display.
Okay. After that, Firelight will run in to try and help the cultist and start fighting the geckos.
At this point, you can basically just swing into them with abandon.
Yeah.
Are there any large rocks sitting around?
There are.
Tempered Steel's gonna start picking them up and hitting them around like baseballs using his hammer.
I don't know if there's a whole lot of room to make up a baseball diamond in here, but all right.
But yes, he is hitting rocks at the fire geckos with his hammer.
You'd probably arrange it more like a golf club than a baseball bat, because the rocks you would have to pitch to make him a baseball, and you don't really have time for that.
I think golf swing.
No, I mean you can do one handed. Pick it up, toss it in the air while you hold the hammer.
With a giant rock?
I'll tell you what. Tibbs is going to buck the rocks to steel to pitch. How about that?
All right. If there's another person involved with your crazy, wacky scheme, then yeah.
Earth Pony strength plus Minotaur strength equals Gecko Baseball.
All right.
All right, then.
Don't hit me.
Both of you roll athletics to enact Gecko
like
Ball.
Operation Gecko Strangle.
Okay.
So anyone else can jump in and start killing geckos.
I wake up.
Oh, goodness.
I rolled a 25 to pitch to steal.
And I got a 26 to hit.
If you had failed, that would have been a strike. But no,
you failed. You steel just gets pelted by rocks.
So yes, you swing your hammer and you managed to successfully hit Tibbs' apparently fastball with a giant rock that just plows into a whole row of fire geckos. Joy and Bill enter the fray, just beating up geckos.
So does Powder Keg.
As does Powder Keg. Slinger and Aurelia open fire.
So do we need to roll for each time we attempt that, or can we just assume we continue to do it successfully?
Unless anyone has anything else to add to this frenzy, I think we can say that you're able to overwhelm the stunned geckos.
No.
Woot.
We did it, gentlemen.
As you're now standing in just a pile of dead fire geckos, and no more seem to be coming through any of the side tunnels, the mayor, with just sort of drenched in blood and kind of still with embers just kind of burning on her cultist robe, just collapses against the far wall, still magically levitating this giant scimitar, and going, Thanks?
Who are you? Hallucinations. Why are you going into shock. You may want to lay down a little bit.
That would make some sense.
Firelight will run up to her and try to heal her.
Alright.
Tibbs will do the same.
Yep. Well, definitely.
As you get closer. Weaver?
Javolt will start poking around the dead fire geckos.
To what end?
Just to see if they work. He remembers that there was a queen, king, leader fire gecko that he disintegrated when they first got to Ripcage, so he's trying to see if there are breeds of fire geckos now.
Oh, yeah, you do actually find a couple of varieties, including one similar to the alpha you disintegrated a while ago.
You said that there's like a big stone with writing on it in the room, right?
Yeah.
Ooh, that's a point.
Yeah, Tempered Steel's gonna go
One thing at a time.
Okay.
As Tibbs and Firelight approach the cultist mare, as you get closer and you become more visible in the lamplight, she just kind of scrambles back a little further and says, No, stay back.
Oh, you're crying out loud, you're bleeding out and you're burned.
You're the dragon maulers.
Yeah, and you're bleeding out.
Yep.
She looks down at herself and then up at you and says, fine, and just tosses the scimitar aside. No, don't really have much of a choice.
No, you don't! You're bleeding!
And thank God that we have the good doctor here to point out the obvious.
Okay. Anyway, Firelight, as soon as she tosses the scimitar aside and let us help, he'll start using his healing magic.
Alright.
Which, I got a 30.
I got a 21 to let's patch this idiot up.
Ah.
Are you sure it's a good idea to help her? She might just turn around and try to kill us or something.
Tibbs is going to look at Powder and then go, yeah, I'm real worried about the injured pony sitting in the middle of this dark cave with, you know,
13.
She's got good odds going up against the rest of us.
Like 13 specialists, yeah.
I'm not saying it for a worry. I'm just saying it because it might be a lost cause.
He has a point. Not a nice point, but he has a point.
Firelight, regardless.
Well, once upon a time, I'm sure you might have said the same thing about Tibbs.
Pretty sure you still think the same thing about me, man.
Almost. He's not wrong.
Believe me.
To be completely fair, there's a difference between being a raider and being a cultist. Mostly
to be completely
in
fair, now that they're working
while
for the executive, not really.
While you bicker, Farley takes the lead on the medicinal effort, and with a 30...
Honestly, gotta be honest here, the raiders here in the mall have done a better job of being better ponies than the cult here, so...
The mayor doesn't say a thing as she listens to you bicker, and Firelight Lots and Tibbs get to work on her. Turns out that her wounds were actually relatively light, save for a few deep scratches that you're able to patch up pretty easily, and she's able to get back on her feet pretty quickly. Probably shouldn't exert herself too strongly for a little while, but she'll be good before too long.
Okay. Lotson will have just been kind of quietly watching her while the two doctors worked on her. and then sort of slowly approach and say, ma'am, believe it or not, we're here to help. Something really
weird is breaking. You're here to kill the dragon.
Sorry?
You're here to kill the dragon, right?
Only if we not have to.
Not necessarily.
What do you mean, nope. Only if you have
we
to?
We are here to...
Well, for every dragon, we've tried to come to a peaceful solution. They just never seem to want to.
Well, no, there was
Death was cool.
Well, Nidhogg was cool, but he wanted to die, so...
You're still going around and destroying the entities we've been worshipping.
To be fair... we're destroying the evil dragons who put curse on this entire Maw and are kind of assholes. Have you actually talked to any of the dragons? They're really not nice, and you know what? They actually really like killing ponies. So, worshipping them is kind of a waste of your time.
Also, we've been breeding them as well.
No, we haven't been breeding them. We respect the dragons as individuals.
We've been breeding them.
Ma'am? Sorry. I'm Flotsam. What's your name?
It's Amber.
Amber. Have you met Ormar? Do you know anything about him?
No. I don't think anyone in the cult has met any of the dragons except for maybe some of the higher-ups in Vizuki. But, I mean, that's just rumor. We officially... I'm just a scout third class. I don't know that much. You're not going to get anything out of me.
No, that's fine. Look, listen, I know you don't like us or anything, but anyone else in this cave is probably in danger from the geckos, just like you were. Is there anyone else down here?
There was my partner.
Dead.
I knew that already, thank you.
I'm sorry. Listen, did you... She kind of looks at the others. Do we get to ask about the you-know-what?
I don't actually know what.
I don't follow.
The orb?
Yeah,
is that what you're talking about? That? Yeah,
yeah,
sure, why not? They're the ones who stole it.
Well, we don't know that. Probably.
Amber lets out a... And just kind of... kind of adjusts herself now that she's bandaged up. Reaches into the pockets in her robes and brings out the great shining refractor core that Tempered Steel recognizes.
I'll bet that's why they were attacking you. They wanted it back.
Oh, there's a refractor core on
mine! And Bill just charges at her.
Tempered Steel is gonna... Okay, where is this refractor core?
It's at the other end of the room with Amber.
Okay, Tempered Steel is gonna rush to try and stop him from, like, trampling her or...
Firelight will also, like, step in between Bill and Amber.
Tibbs is going to turn around and buck Bill in the face.
I'm going to go walk up to the words on the wall.
Bill is charging full speed. Roll either in endurance or athletics to repel him.
Okay!
That's...
Like, this is a full-on buffalo charge.
Powder Keg will also roll athletics to stop him, and I get to roll twice. So that's a 33.
I rolled a 24.
Okay, I disconnected. What happened?
Oh, Bill's attempting to charge the orb because he's...
Right, I
roll
got the
either acrobatics or endurance.
At her.
I was wondering if Flotsam...
I was athletics or endurance because we have to be strong enough to stop him. We can't acrobatically stop him.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you could.
I was trying to have Steel move to intercept Bill.
Yeah, you can move to intercept, but you gotta roll athletics or endurance to be able to, like, stop him.
Oh, I can roll endurance.
Flotsam, what did you want to do?
Sorry?
Yeah, you were trying to do a thing?
I was. I was wondering if during the commotion, in order to make sure that it's out of range of Bill, if Flotsam could dart forward, snatch the orb from Amber, and fly out of reach.
Roll athletics to do that.
Is it safe to assume that a 20 is not going to cut it?
It's a little weak.
Okay.
Powder Keg got a 33.
Powder Keg did
get
a 33, though.
Who got a 33? Powder Keg?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's just shy of a natural 20 for him.
Yep, it is just shy of a natural 20.
Yep.
Well, so if we're working together as a group, we should be able to.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we got this.
With, Tibbs and Powder Keg and Firelight, Tempered Steel. So Flotsam, you You kind of 14, so. You dash for the refracted core, but the way things are just going very quickly, you aren't quite able to get out of the way in time. You're able to grab it, but not quite able to get out of the way in time before Bill has, you know, reaches there with his charge. But the other four of you just push back against him, and Powderkeg in particular, you follow up with just a high power, just butt to the face, just poof, and he just goes reeling back. And then you see him kind of his back hooves just kind of swept out from under him as Joy just kind of grabs him with her forehooves and lifts, and you see him just like flip end over end as she just friggin' wrestling throws him backwards. Bill just collides against the ground and just stops moving out cold.
Well,
right. Damn it,
this
you,
thing
has the buffalo.
Has some power over Bill, I guess.
Well, nobody look at it, okay? Be careful looking at it and touching it, because, yes, that
Flotsam.
Thing...
Yeah?
Are you taking care to not look at it too closely?
Flotsam pointedly looks away from it.
Alright.
Because, yes, that thing has a power over him, and I know from experience that it's not him alone.
Has Flotsam actually wrested it from Amber?
Yeah, you managed to wrest it away from Amber.
Somebody...
Flotsam
Can
flies
I
out
of it. Check it? Somebody put some rag over that thing.
I was just going to say, Flotsam flies out of reach and puts it in her saddlebag.
Okay, never mind that.
Amber nods and says, it's not too difficult as long as you're aware that it has that kind of effect, but yeah, we had to be careful as well.
Who gave you this assignment?
It was part of our, general assignment when we were sent to Ribcage.
Quick question. Do we remember seeing either her or her dead partner hanging around Cookie Crumbles when we saw him earlier?
Not this morning, but the day before when you first got to Ribcage.
Yes.
They were kind of at a stall helping them hand out pamphlets.
Okay.
Their hoods were up, though, so you couldn't really see their features, but it's safe to assume that these are the same two cultists.
So you weren't just sent here to help out Cookie Crumbles?
That was our cover.
Do you know what the core does?
Huh?
The core. You were bringing it back here, right?
Well, it was mainly Crumb's idea, but we figured that it was, I don't know, it's some kind of power core that powers something, I don't know, but we figured
I have a look at it then.
Whatever, Flotsam, if you want, you can hand over the core to Javolt.
She looks skeptical. Javolt, will you be careful and not get all crazy?
I'll try my best.
If you start getting crazy, we're going to have to take it away from you, okay?
Of course.
She will hoof it over to him, again, being careful not to look at it.
Can I try to figure out what this thing does with Arcana?
Yeah, you can.
And since my destiny gives me a plus 10 bonus to checks made to identify the nature of magical effects, would that also count?
Actually, with this, it would.
Alrighty then. So that's 1d20 plus 24 total, so... And I got 40.
With a 40, You can tell just almost at a glance that this crystal, it provides a special kind of magical energy, and the way the sort of sockets are set up, it's meant to plug in almost like a sort of circuit breaker into this some kind of massive, very powerful machine. The nature of which is kind of hard to say, but you get the sense just from the sort of magical energies contained that there is some sort of kinetic effect. It's meant to move something. It's meant to like either move something or to open something.
Hmm.
Amber, do you know what the orcs were?
All we knew was that... You see, you know, the Dragonstone here.
Yeah.
We were passing the... We suspected it was here and that the geckos were being affected by it. So they were compelled to sort of... She gestures vaguely at the machinery around the Dragonstone. She shakes her head and says, I suppose you guys are my only chance of being able to see a dragon myself now.
Lots of nods.
Can I arcana check the Dragonstone as well?
Before Javolt does that, Lotson would like to kind of glance over and say, hey, Zenkarn, what does it say? Because Zenkarn was looking at it, right?
Yep.
Aurelia is looking at it as well.
Many times.
Tempered Steel's going to tap it with his hammer.
Of course.
We have a time on the tradition.
Wow, that's a blast from the past. That actually hasn't been,
Well, to be fair, when was the last time we actually, you know, stood in front of Dragonstone?
That's fair. You didn't have to do that for the blood or backstab curse zones. Because, one, the dragon just kind of came out to meet you, and two, it was kind of plainly obvious where the lair was. It was just exceedingly dangerous to go there.
Yep.
But tapping the Dragonstone with your hammer doesn't really seem to do anything.
Okay, he's gonna give it one strong swing to see if that gets a bigger reaction.
That causes sort of a resonating, high-pitched sound, but not much more than that.
So what's it say?
Just a second, can you hear that?
Yeah, I can hear a lot of fuzz.
A lot of what?
Give me a sec, probably me.
Well, I wasn't talking about the fuzz, I was talking about some background noise on my end through the door and off on the other side of the apartment. But... Alright, I hope that's not on the recording. Goodness, where was I? There were like 15 things going on. One of which was Amber was in the middle of a sentence.
It was,
The Dragonstone, the draconic writing on the Dragonstone reads much like the ones before it. A curse upon thee is our righteous vengeance. Guns, gold, magic, machines, blood, betrayal, and death, our ruin shall be thy ruin everlasting. And it repeats that across the height and length of the Dragonstone.
Okay, Tempered Steel is going to try and use it to increase his knowledge of the dragon language.
You can do that.
Okay, what is it? Is it knowledge?
Just you do it.
That tone, Spud. That tone.
You're just so done. You're like, this is not what's going on right now. Please, focus. Focus, please.
Anyway.
At this point, you're starting to gain a, you're starting to become a little bit literate in Draconic.
So that adds what percent?
Forget percentage. You now have a passing ability to read and write Draconic now.
Sweet.
Yay!
You've been at this for so long and so persistently that now it's starting to become an actual level of genuine literacy. Not a high level yet, but
it's like after taking maybe 2 or 3 years of Spanish high school.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've got it written down as passing literacy of dragon language.
Yes. That is a thing.
All right, then.
Woo!
So, yeah, can Javolt try to figure out the magical properties of this dragonstone? Again?
Yeah, you can do that. Do you still have the refractor on you?
Yeah. I'm still holding it.
All right.
Should I roll?
Yeah, roll
Arcana. Arcana for that?
Roll
with
Arcana.
The plus 10 bonus? With the plus 10 bonus, or?
I wouldn't call this a magical device, per se, so.
Well, it's not magical device. It gives me a plus 10 bonus to identify the nature of magical effects.
Yes, you can.
Okay.
To identify the nature of it.
Alright. I got a 31 total, which is not a natural one, but it's pretty low.
You can tell that Dragonstone is, like many others in the Wasteland, is kind of a nexus for the major dragon's magic that helps kind of spread the curse. And the geckos being so close to this Dragonstone for so long probably affected them to affected their values so that they would...
How much more would he learn if I decided to boost his roll?
Not a whole lot more. It's still pretty high. Okay. So anyway, as I was trying to say, so yeah, the geckos were definitely affected by this thing. It also seems that if with the refractor you have with you, it seems that the items that have been gathered around it also kind of gain a certain level of resonance because they are their machinery. And you can probably, the dragon zones can also be used to kind of find the way back to the source, to the dragon.
Right.
So maybe touch the resonance stone to the thing?
Touch the stone to the stone.
It's a dragon divining rod.
What was thundered and undone shall behold the two made one.
You are... Yeah, Bill had retrieved this item from this hoard before, and now you're returning it. So do you touch
the... So Jubolt very cautiously approaches the dragonstone and says, "Right. If I'm right, when I touch this to this, there will be a lot of rumbling, and we might either move on a platform to the dragon, or a door will open. Basically, there will be a big thing moving."
Or a giant touch beam the like the last two.
All right. Jubolt touches the thing to the thing.
You touch the refractor core... item to the dragon stone, and it shines, yep. And the cave rumbles a little bit, only a little bit, barely enough to dislodge some dust in the cave ceiling, and the draconic script kind of moves and flows across the stone until it reads something very different. What is it?
It's free pizza available when you order one large with one topping or more.
Woohoo! Free pizza!
Do 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 do! Do 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 do
do do do do do do do do do. Meanwhile, okay. In town of evening.
Okay. So, where was I? Oh yes, rumbling, shining, moving draconic script into a new configuration, and then this great big shining beam shoots out back towards the tunnel and kind of bounces off the walls. And also the pit buck that Slinger is wearing kind of goes a little haywire as well.
Uh-oh.
What does the new script say?
The new script on the Dragonstone says, "Here I have amassed the tools of our mutual destruction. Sacrifice yourselves upon the altar of your hubris in the name of technological advancement."
God damn it.
What?
I can see where he's coming from, but that's sort of only half of the
Aurelia kind of squints at the writing and says, "Huh, didn't realize dragons had a word for technological, but there it is."
Well, I guess they had to if this guy was like this.
Any of the technology in the hoard around the stone look dangerous or look like it's becoming dangerous?
A lot of it seems to be kind of either inert or broken. The refractor core is the only one that seems like it's really intact or useful.
Okay, so none of the stuff looks like it's about to explode.
No.
Okay. Hey, someone want to fly up there and see if they can see where that light is pointing to?
Slinger kind of goes, "I think I know what it's pointing at."
What is it pointing at?
For whatever reason, there's a new marker on the Pitbuck map.
Oh boy, what does it say?
He flaps on over to you guys and shows you the Pitbuck screen, where he has highlighted about kind of off to the side, kind of between, not like to the side, but off another part of the machine curse zone, there is a marker for... what is labeled? Vault 998.
Vault 998, huh?
Do you mean stable?
Oh, stable. Stable 998, yeah.
Okay, so whoever was looking to get to see a stable looks like they get their wish.
That was me. I've been waiting for this.
Stable!
I have been annoyed at the lack of stables.
Stable.
Not
so
like,
wait.
You know, angrily annoyed, but like, you this know, like kind of like, I wish there were stables. I want stables.
So what? I'm interpreting the situation correctly, the technology cursed dragon puts the changeling hive into the stable for reasons presumably relating to revenge on ponies.
We don't know if that's what happened, says Chica.
Nope.
How about we stop theorizing and go have a look? It'd be a lot quicker.
Would it be safe to presume that there's a lot of this, that there's too much cave for us to be able to assume we can explore?
Well, actually, you've seen most of it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Chica's actually kind of inspecting the area as well.
I guess I thought high.
So, Chica, does this match any of your knowledge of changeling hives? These architecture?
Well, if there was, in theory, a group of changelings hiding out somewhere in the Badlands many, many, many years ago, it would probably look like this. But, and she kind of digs around at the outer wall of the shrine room and unearths a little bit of what looks like this sort of, I don't know, dried green, either ash or some kind of residue. Yeah, I think there was a hive here at one point, but centuries ago. I don't know. It doesn't look like they died here, though, or killed. It looks like, I don't know, they packed up and moved.
I don't to see, stable I'm, 998?
Maybe.
A quick question. Was the cultist ever given a name? The cultist?
Amber, writer? Yeah.
Amber. I knew she had a name. Sorry. So, Amber, would you like to visit one of your dragons? Jubal gestures down the beam of light.
I'd rather not with you, but I don't think I have much of a choice.
No, you could,
we saved your life and haven't killed you yet. You maybe consider that the cult might be wrong about us?
No.
I was warned that you were shrewd as well.
True. Yes, well, like I said, we are not devoted to destroying dragons, but ending curses. Or did I say that? I think someone upset us that.
Hey, look, if we can get him to end the curse without, you know, killing him, that'd be great. In fact, if we can get him to get on good terms, it would be nice, because we haven't found one that's actually nice since Nidhogg.
You ever considered that, you know, and I know you're not cultist, so this isn't going to make sense to you, but do you ever think that maybe we deserve having these curses on us?
Nope.
Yeah.
No, not really.
For what ponies did 200 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
You guys did 200 years ago.
Put it this way.
We don't need to suffer for the sins of our fathers.
Well, not even our fathers. Like fathers, fathers or something.
Point is, I subscribe to the child does not need to suffer for the sins of his father. And when you have many generations removed from the ones that had the problem, no, we really don't deserve it. Maybe the ponies who caused this deserve it.
Killing an entire race, though?
We didn't cause that. The ponies who did that? Yeah, sure, maybe they do deserve this, but we ain't them.
May I say something?
Flotsam said, being drowned out once again. Even by the DM, sorry.
Amber, I actually agree with you. I think, as a race, we did some really crappy things. We're monsters, basically. We still are. That hasn't changed yet. And maybe you're right that we do deserve a lot of what's going wrong, but at some point we have to let go of the past and move forward. This isn't just bad for us. This is bad for them, too. We saw what it did to Nidhogg. He was the only one who understood that the revenge just twisting up inside of him, it made it so that there was no joy to be had in living anymore. And the others that we met, they were just so full of rage. Regardless of what we deserve, the dragons don't deserve to be instruments of revenge anymore. They need to be set free. They need to be at peace. She kind of looks earnestly at Amber. Do you kind of understand where I'm coming from?
I do. And maybe some part of me agrees, but I know for a fact none of my bosses would.
That's fine. But listen, I know that you've heard really bad things about us, and I'm not going to try and tell you otherwise. You just need to see what we're about and come to your own decision about us, okay?
Amber unsteadily gets back onto all four hooves. At this point, I'm basically a failure and a traitor for not stopping you, but for me, the only way back into my home now is to find a way to the dragon and find a way to protect him or stop you from killing him or something.
Hey, if you can convince him not to kill us and everything, I'm all for it.
I think she's going to try to do the opposite of that.
I really hope not, but...
If you're willing to... I above all that, though, I have to admit, I... Despite everything I've lost, being able to see a dragon would make it all worth it.
Jabal is going to point
at Aurelia.
Yeah.
One of the old dragons. No offense, Aurelia. But you've been corrupted. You're less dragon than you are pony at this point. And Aurelia just puts her hands on her hips and goes, "Hey! I am totally a dragon." She spits out a little fire at that.
Well,
she totally is.
We know you're a dragon, even if she doesn't.
Yeah, you tell him, Aurelia.
To me, the core of a dragon is pride. Pride in one's accomplishments, oneself, one's family.
It's not just pride, basically, but power.
No. Dragons are powerful because they are
power. They are proud because they are powerful.
If you part of the cult, if you'd studied, you would understand that.
Well, give Aurelia a few decades or maybe a few centuries. Look, I don't know how dragon growth works, but give her some time and I'm sure she'll have the same kind of power.
Staying with ponies, I don't know about that. She looks around and says,
I might be willing to think your cult was less awful if it weren't for the fact that you're kind of working for about the worst pony I've ever met,
I thought we already agreed that that was to do with, you know, corruption in the higher-ups. Most of the cultists just want to worship dragons, and that's pretty harmless.
Except the higher-ups are making everything harmful.
You know what, maybe we can discuss this on the road, and maybe we should get to where we can actually look at those, we can actually get to the dragon.
Yeah, good idea.
So our next point of business, will we be traveling underground or above ground for this
Above.
Trip? I got the impression there wasn't any underground.
This is the end of the cave.
Yeah, there's no underground path.
Oh.
The beam is kind of bouncing through the tunnel and kind of like pointing at the location outside.
Devolt just sadly puts down his shovel.
I'm just going to blame that on the technical curse affecting my goggles, yes.
Tempered Steel is going to begin his way outside the cave.
Amber, her walk is a little unsteady, but says, "Will you allow me to travel with you?"
I'm
good with it, yeah. And as a bonus, you can talk to our young corrupted dragon about your beliefs and whatnot, and maybe uncorrupt her or something.
She shakes her head and says, I'm no missionary. I just believe what I believe.
Just a quick warning, though. If you try and kill us, we're probably going to have to try and kill you back. Sound good?
That was a given.
Okay.
Besides, I'm a scout, third class, not even a hybrid. I know what my odds are.
Glances at Slinger.
What is Slinger thinking about everything going on right now?
Slinger is just kind of just been glaring at her almost the whole time.
Slinger, do you know this pony?
I don't, but she's part of the cult.
You were too before you knew better.
Yeah, and this one doesn't, so maybe you should reconsider letting her travel with you. And Amber doesn't say anything to that.
Tibbs is going to look over to Slinger and go, "Quit scowling, mate. Your face is going to stick like that."
By the way, is Bill okay?
Bill's still unconscious.
Should we wait until Bill wakes up?
Joy kind of shakes her head and says, "I think, well, we were here to deal with the fire geckos, and we're kind of done." She looks up to Slinger and says, "We should probably head back to Ripcage and let them know that the job's done. You know, that is, if any of them aren't already heading off towards where that big beam of light is pointing."
Wait, are we sure we just want to leave him here? Are we sure that's good?
Slinger and I can help him back to town.
Okay.
Before you do that, Javolt is going to move some of the technology stuff around and put the refractor core under it, and then move the technology stuff over it so it's not visible.
You're going to leave the refractor core behind?
What?
No, we're not. It's a mechanism. What are you doing, Javolt? No, if Powder Keg sees Javolt trying to do that, he snags the mechanism and puts it in his saddlebag.
Well, I thought we would have to hide it from being found, or at least give Bill some plausible explanation as to where it went.
We're taking it with us.
Joy just says, you can leave that to me.
You're going to say one of the geckos that it did, aren't you?
I can handle coming up with an explanation that'll give him time to wean off whatever this influence is. Don't worry about that.
All right.
He's one of ours I'll take care of.
Thanks,
Joy. You still look familiar.
So you don't remember that bender you went on, did you? Probably
not
for the best.
Not entirely.
Probably for the best.
Hmm. Did I... This is going to be awkward, but if I was drunk, did I make advances that I should apologize for?
By advances, you mean charging at my liquor cabinet and getting thrown back as a result. Maybe you should apologize for that.
Ah. Yes, well, obviously, stealing's wrong, and I am sorry for that.
But no, you made no such motions as that, so be grateful. I have certainly seen worse benders out of ponies, but yours was fairly bad. But yours more had to do with grief than the drink, anyway.
Grief? Huh. How would I be grieving?
Oh god, I have to go through all this again.
You weren't drunk when the grief happened. You don't forget that.
I start walking.
Well, I mean, I do have some mild brain damage. It might not have clicked, I don't know.
We'll talk about this later when we're not about to get eaten by a dragon.
I don't think that the undead dragons actually eat ponies anymore.
Kind of phrase. Then can't wait for me.
Later, we'll look into actually fixing your brain damage.
Watson picks up Craggy and goes to catch up with Zenkarn.
Firelight will start
with Zenkarn. I really want my brain tampered with. I mean, it is now an aspect of my personality. Where does the problem end and the person begin?
Oh,
that's
God.
The real question. So I guess we're all walking out.
Yeah, you're all starting to march.
I imagine that
Outer Keg is plugging his ears.
I was about to say, I imagine this diatribe continues for quite some time as we're walking.
Yeah. Powder keg long and shortly into the walk, picks some rocks off the ground and just hovers them over his ears with his magic.
While they're walking, can Blotsam get hints and tips on necromancy from Zenkarn?
Yeah, you can do that.
Yeah, just mentally just start sending us stuff, because talking over Javolt's probably difficult.
Yeah, Javolt's kind of talking in the background, and Zenkarn and Flotsam are just having a private mental conversation about proper summoning technique.
By the time you get out of the cave and back onto the surface, the beam starts to peter out until it's no longer shining anymore, pointing the way.
But we still know where it goes, right?
Yeah. Slinger, as you know, they start to. Joy seems to be just kind of single-hoofedly carrying Bill back to Ribcage. Slinger slips off the pit buck from his hand and turns it off and hands it back to Flotsam.
Thank you. She slips it back on and obviously leaves it turned off.
He just points off in the direction the beam was shining before and says, just straight on, I probably won't be able to miss it. Although it's been hidden for a while, so. But yeah, you should be fine. I'll be back in Ribcage. Good luck, all of you.
You too.
Good luck. And he starts flying off after Joy. Amber walks up beside you all and says, so, onward?
Onward!
I suppose so.
Oh, yeah. Well, you stopped while Slinger was, you know.
Yeah. We stopped
getting ready to part ways.
So, Javolt's going to start up a debate on power versus pride as the center of dragon.
Amber's not going to have any of that. She's tired of the conversation.
Blotsam is now mentally asking Zenkarn about how to do that walk-through-wall spell.
It seems that Amber is not really an evangelist so much as she has a couple of opinions. And a very, very quiet religious type. Mm. Oh, and I should probably mention, Amper wanted to make sure that you picked up a few effects off of her partner's corpse as you were leaving.
So even if Dave hadn't reminded us, we still would have got the holotype.
But yeah, you got the holotype, and she grabbed a few personal items off of him as well to, you know, sort of sign, you know, badges and whatnot that were part of his robe, and presumably just so she can report that he was KIA.
And just the moment where she's looking at him and going, "Why is he naked?"
What happened to the robe?
It's in a powder keg saddlebag, and she'll never know that it's there.
Well, she probably would have asked.
Powder keg says he has no idea.
Powder keg.
And then Javolt spoils it.
No! What?
I
think you mean Firelight spoils it.
Oh, Firelight. You were quiet.
Sorry.
I have no idea what you're talking about. I did not disrobe a dead pony. That's abhorrent.
Amber just rolls her eyes. Anyway, do we have time to... Yeah, let's just do it. You travel along the appointed path for a good long while. You pass by a few ruined buildings on your way that are just too bombed out to really find any salvage or make any sense of. And then, kind of directly in the way, up on this sort of raised hilly area, is kind of bigger than a shack, but kind of a small house on the hill.
Is there anything suspicious looking about it?
It looks, actually, the main thing about it is that it looks kind of very sturdy compared to any other structures out here. It seems to be made of wood, but otherwise completely intact, which is kind of odd considering the bombing this place would have taken a long time ago.
It could be built newer.
It doesn't seem that way.
Okay, is there any...
The style doesn't seem like any sort of modern style.
Are there any signs that it's a trap, or it has traps with it?
Doesn't seem so.
Okay, are there any windows?
There are a couple of windows.
Okay, Timbersteel's gonna see if he can, spot anything through the window for signs of what the place might be.
You look inside and you see kind of a normal, you're looking through what seems like a kitchen window. Seems like a normal sort of house setup. It looks like there's actually, you see past the kitchen through to what looks like a living room, and it seems like there's a lot of pink in there, a lot of kind of girly looking plushies and toys inside.
Huh.
Toys.
And all of this is like very intact.
Yeah.
Now this, was Sorry, this... What? Was this, okay, I missed it, but was this the place we were heading to, or is this something we're passing by?
It's like directly on your path. The beam could have, for all you know, been pointing directly at it.
Okay.
And it seems to be about the right distance away from the cave that the pit bug map was pointing at.
Okay,
this is a building?
Yeah, it's a building.
Or what is, yeah,
it's
okay.
A small little house.
Okay, Tempered Seal's going to go and knock on the door, the front door.
Javolt is going to sort of flick an ear at this.
And you hear a, what sounds like a little filly inside.
Flotsam will call out. God, I hope so. Flotsam will call out, "Hello? Anyone in there?"
Oh, no.
No, yes. No one's here.
Yes. Fucking yes.
If there's no one here, who's talking in there?
You don't get a response to that.
Didn't think that through, did you?
Flotsam is going to go out on a limb here. Golden Crown?
You don't hear anything.
Tempestil's going to knock on the door again.
Is the door locked?
You hear on the other side, Flotsam.
Hi. Fancy meeting you out here.
You hear like a dozen locks on the inside unlatch before the door finally opens. And the door opens to no one at first, but then you hear a pfft, and Golden Crown walks around from the other side of the door. It's like she jumped up to turn the handle.
Well.
Have you heard the good word of the dragons?
I imagine he gets a very dirty look from Amber at that point.
Yeah, yeah, he does.
Oh my god.
This is a nice place.
And she just kind of looks indignantly at you and says, how did you find out about my secret base?
We walked by it.
Yeah.
There are like four answers all at once. And she just...
Well, to be completely fair, we found an ancient magical device which, according to which, imprinted a map on Flotsam's Pitbuck. And okay, according to the map, this is actually the entrance to a stable.
Short thing. We activated this thing. Light, big lone light in the sky pointed us here. Stable down here.
What? No, why would you think that? She says, kind of her eyes darting left and right.
Oh, you do know about the stable. Good, I was wondering about that. Is that where you got all your caps from?
No.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's where you got your caps from. And are there still ponies living down there?
I don't know.
Really? But you've been down there.
Are there changes?
I have been in the entranceway to the vault, but I haven't actually ever opened the vault door.
Oh.
Today's a good day to do that.
Okay, question. How is this place so pink?
Hey, you questioning my sense of style, my taste in decorations?
Yes,
you found a Pinkie Pie hideout, didn't you?
Flotsam just scowls. Flotsam scowls at Firelight.
What? She needs a new decorator.
I think it's for adorable. a little mafia queen. I would have expected something. Oh, what's the reward?
Yeah, pink sounds about right.
I love your stuffed animals. My brother had one like that when we were younger. He points.
So, okay, Temperate Steel's going to start walking around the building, seeing if there's potentially an entrance on the outside.
There is not.
Alright. So,
she just kind of says, alright, just don't touch anything, don't put anything out of place. I'll go open up the entranceway thing, and she darts off.
Okay, what is the main entryway like?
It's a normal door.
I guess we're invited in.
The room they enter.
It's kind of a living room. Very Where's small the living room.
Pink plushie that Firelight can pick up and start examining.
You examine the plushie and kind of picking it up, it seems a bit heavier than it should be.
Oh my god! I'll shake it. Does it sound like it's full of caps?
It does, actually.
Okay, Temperance Steel's gonna look at another gonna find the biggest stuffed animal there is.
It's a big old Pinkie Pie plushie, like almost full sized.
Is it feel like it's full of caps too?
It definitely seems like there's a bit more actual like stuffing in there, but yes, it does jingle with caps a little bit.
Firelight is now on the ground laughing. Of course, this is where she would hide all of her money.
Be fair, she's still young.
Oh man,
she's actually done quite well for.
Oh man,
someone who I'm going to back out of this before.
Wait! Was she keeping money in the stuffed animals?
Yes. Oh my god.
Yes.
Tib.
That's priceless.
I know. I can't believe
it. Well, it is kind of cute. That's why I'm laughing. It's cute.
Tibbs, so, it's funny. Do we just break our stuffed animals, or do we just nick our stuff?
No, we're not going to take anything of hers. We'll just let her keep it. Not much point. Let's just get to the vault.
I'm not actually going
to
take anything, but Tibbs, do you have a scalpel? I've always wanted to do
autopsy. No. Javolt actually grabs Firelight at this and says, no. You do not want to upset this child.
Tibbs is actually kind of scowling at the mockery of the stuffed animals. And what he's going to do is, you may laugh at this, but you ever been hit with a sack full of caps? And he's going to proceed to pick up one of the stuffed animals and basically smack Firelight upside the head with it. Surprisingly good weapon.
One.
I was. It was a joke.
Don't hurt it! It's... I'll put some snacks in the blanket.
Don't hurt the plushie.
Don't hurt the poor plushie! Okay, so,
Devolt is now rubbing his forehead, and he's like...
You know, I think I actually have been smacked with bags of caps a few times.
Oh, I wasn't actually going to do it, Tibbs. Destroy a child's toy.
Sort of gestures at everyone who's playing with the plushies and says, are we the only mature people here?
I take offense at that. I'm not gonna justify you.
Not even gonna once.
Tempered Steel is gonna sit down and he's going to have the Pinkie Pie plushie and he's gonna position it so it's like the Pinkie Pie is holding his hammer in his inner front arms.
And then the session screeched to a halt so that the party could play with a whole bunch of plushies.
Yeah, alright. Anyway, so eventually we get her coming back.
Yeah, she kinda comes back up from the back of the house and says, alright, you can come on down now.
As everyone's holding plushies.
Hey, those are mine, don't
You might want to pick a better hiding place.
All I can think as she walks in, there's the dragon maulers and like everyone else is sitting in a circle having this tea party, and she's just like, no, I'm done, that's it.
At the better hiding place comment, Tibbs is going to pick up another stuffed animal and hold it threateningly at Firelight.
Blotsam is just going around taking the stuffed animals from everyone and putting them back.
Oh, come on, I never had stuffed toys as a kid.
Tempered Steel is going to playfully try and maneuver it so that it's like the Pinkie Pie plushie is carrying his hammer over her shoulder as they head towards the vault entrance.
No, that Flotsam took the plushie away from you, remember? She just said that.
Well, yeah, but she can grab it again.
No, just leave it. Just leave
it. Flotsam will bap you on the nose.
Those are not yours to play with.
Yeah,
you know, I got to play with these as a kid, though. I set all mine on fire.
Then
Flotsam looks very alarmed.
That's no problem.
Pushes Firelight the hell away from them.
I'm not going to do it now.
Firelight, you just better check yourself before you wreck yourself.
Okay, I'm going to stop now.
Very sorry about my associates. They...
Whatever, just come on.
Well, I do have to ask how many of the... I mean, the plushies may be yours, but how many of the caps inside of them are yours?
Tempered, put me back.
Not good time.
As we're going downstairs, Flotsam is passive percepting for traps.
Alright, yeah, I'll keep that in mind. You head on towards this back, this sort of closet door, which leads into a downward staircase. That goes on for quite a while, and then it turns around for another flight of long stairs before opening up into kind of a long steel hallway. And there are a couple of rooms off to either side, one of which looks like a workshop. The other looks like kind of a sort of maintenance computer room. And the floor looks like it's been recently mopped. There's a mop and bucket nearby.
Did you tidy up in here?
Just inside one of the rooms. She says, oh, yeah, I just wanted to, you know, make it look nice and all. Whatever.
Oh, did you kill someone down here?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
You know, there was some leftover blood, you know, clean up and whatnot, so, you know.
It happens.
Powderkick is just kind of looking at Flotsam like, how well do I know this filly?
What is this about blood cleanup?
I get where she's coming from. But yeah, at the line of killed one person, I'm going to use my detect corpses thing. So any corpses or undead entities within 100 feet.
You don't detect any.
Well, of course not.
I look at Crown, I'm like, where'd you put the body?
None of your beeswax. Come on, you want to see the stable or not?
Yeah,
you didn't actually.
Oh, wait, are you?
Did you?
There used to be someone else who owned this place and you killed them.
She yeah, didn't. Basically.
She's clean.
Is she telling the truth when she says that?
Is she?
I'm willing to take
gonna roll. What would that be? Is that perception or?
Is it...
It's rain. Now that's its news.
Great perception to see if she's telling the truth on that.
That would be perception, yeah.
Gonna roll perception with I know that twitch, so I get a bonus.
I know it's not really important, but I'm just curious now.
Same here. Oh, I got a nat 20.
Well,
I got a...
Oh, okay. So, yeah. Firelights, did she actually kill anyone? Did I cut it out?
You did not. I'm just waiting for anyone else to roll.
I rolled a 27 for liar.
Going to believe her.
All right. Flotsam, you look a little unsure, but you don't really have any reason to not believe her. But Tibbs and Firelight especially, she is lying. She's very much lying about what happened down here.
All right. Who did you actually kill?
None of these facts, okay? I don't have to tell you everything about my life. Come on, there's sable doors just this way.
I think the thing is she didn't actually kill anyone, and she's just making up
a blood. You're both talking.
Sound.
Right. Yeah, you're both talking.
Anyone else thinking we should make her enter the vault with us so that she can't try to pull some stunt like locking us in?
Like,
two of us can now walk through walls. I don't think she's going to be able to lock us in.
But, like, genuinely... Not just the spirit walk, but genuinely phase.
She's not going to pull
yes,
anything.
Yes, both Flotsam and Zenkarn can phase step through walls.
Oh, okay.
Oh, in that case.
But yes, I would not put it past Golden Crown to try a stunt like that.
Eh, she's fine.
So
Tibbs, she leads you down the hall. Do you follow?
Tibbs will follow.
Yes. Absolutely. Yes.
Passive perception still on.
No, you don't really detect any traps, although plenty of security systems, a couple of cameras that don't seem to be active. Like, not recording, but they do seem to have a motion.
Tempered Steel's going to go to one of them and he's going to wave his hand in front of it slowly to see what kind of reaction he gets.
It doesn't track your movements.
Okay.
So, Miss Crown, was it?
Yeah, it's Golden Crown. Don't wear it out.
If this is the source of your mysterious windfall caps, do you get new caps from, say, behind this vault door, or...?
I ain't in the business of telling any pony about where I get my caps from, other than my business.
You do know about the economic concept of inflation, don't you?
Javon?
No.
I don't really think inflation's going to be too much of a big deal.
Linky seemed worried about it.
Yeah. And Smacktop was saying on the radio that there's a lot of caps coming in, so inflation's going to be kind of an issue. But I think that might be more to do with the executive. We'll kind of have to see.
Well, let me just say then, to make you feel better, that I'm not spending as many caps as people seem to think I have. And I'll tell you that because Flotsam is a friend.
Flotsam
I look a lot more wealthy than I actually am, but...
Okay.
I got enough to live out here very comfortably.
As Flotsam is a friend... What did you kill?
None of your beeswax. Tibbs, not that great a friend.
Tibbs at this point is going to...
Firelight.
Tibbs is going to elbow Firelight in the ribs.
Powder Kick is just kind of shaking his head.
I think you're missing
Firelight,
point.
Just give it up already.
The point is, I don't think she actually killed anyone here. She's just bluffing to make herself look tough.
So?
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Can
that's,
we just move along?
That's why Tibbs is elbowing Firelight, because it doesn't matter.
I don't know, I'm kind of curious.
Curiosity killed the fucking cat or something. Just shut up, all of y'all.
And satisfaction brought it back. Remember the end of that before you pointed at me.
So anyway...
Just,
I can't say I've ever heard the second half.
Are you
going
to get a move on, or do I have to call one of my bodyguards down here to move you along?
Good luck to them.
Flotsam is still trotting along next to her.
Tibbs is also still going.
All right.
Powder Keg never stopped.
All right.
Flotsam actually leans in to kind of whisper to Golden Crown, "Hey, if you ever do want to talk business, I'll make sure I only bring the less chatty ones with me."
All right. She just rolls her eyes and says, "All right." Finally, the hall opens out to, if you've ever been to, a stable before, this will look very familiar with the great big, stable wheel door.
They're basically like the vault doors from Fallout, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the one in Glarung's. thing. I'm pretty sure he had
one.
There
was a vault door, a kind of repurposed vault door.
But like, for example, Fallout 3, that place you start out in, it's
Okay. Except kind of a hall instead of a cave.
I can understand.
But yeah, and the number on it is 998.
I didn't know they made this many.
It's a lot like in Fallout 3, the place you go to rescue your dad, I would bet. Under the house
with the stuff.
Yeah. Anyone who's played Fallout 3 knows what I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah.
That was a good game.
Let's get a move on.
Not terribly stable these days. I keep trying to replay it. But anyway, there's kind of a console nearby. It doesn't seem like there's a whole lot of power, though. And off kind of to the side of the door, there is, I don't know how to describe it, just sort of kind of a power box looking thing.
Flotsam looks shiny-eyed at the console and the power box. Do you think they work?
Kelton Golden Crown says, why. I don't know, they haven't worked in since I got down here.
Well,
as far as I know, we might really open it from the inside.
Or Powder Keg's gonna kind of pull the thing out of his, pull the refractor core out and look for a place where it might fit.
It looks about the size of the sort of closed power box off to the right.
He throws it in there.
Well, you opened it up and you hear kind of a whirring from there's kind of this opening, but not really much for to put it into, but it kind of opens up this sort of mechanical door on the inside, and this tray kind of slides out with a slot that pretty much exactly fits the refractor core.
All right, Powder Kick puts that in there.
The refractor core clicks into place, and the tray slides back in. The door, the inside door is closed, and you hear a brrrr as things start to power up. The console lights start to blink.
Watson is over at the console in a flash.
And steam, you know, it sounds like steam and like gas hissing as pneumatic pistons start to come back to life and whirring of gears, and sounds like a whole bunch of systems just kind of coming back to life and kind of going through diagnostics.
Hmm.
So do we roll mechanics to see whatever's on the terminal?
It's not really much of a it's not a terminal. It's just kind of
a console
with lights and
console.
Yeah, with levers and whatnot. It's a control panel basically.
For opening the door, perhaps.
Probably
there is one lever that's door control.
Flotsam pulls the door. Flotsam will examine the console first just to make sure there's it's not going to explode on them.
Console seems to be fully functioning. Nothing's wrong with any of the wiring or the lights or anything. This is stable tech. It seems built to last.
Javolt grabs Flotsam and pulls it back and says, we are in the technology curse zone. It might be better to let Aurelia pull this lever.
Oh, yeah, good idea.
Aurelia says, yeah, probably really good. All right, so should I throw the switch?
Sure.
Aurelia just kind of goes for the console, puts a hand on the lever, and says, "Well, funny thing, a lot of firsts you get when you were hatched like a few weeks ago, right?" And then just slams the switch down. Alarm starts to blare. The lights in the hall dim as the stable door slowly pulls out. And that's where we're gonna leave it for tonight.
I saw that coming.
Yeah. That was kind of obvious.
Good cliffhanger.
I'm not surprising anyone with that
cliffhanger. It's 10:23. It's both a thematically perfect cliffhanger and a timing cliffhanger. We've already gone over our normal time.
The one thing I was expecting was like it start to creak open and we see eyes on the other side or something.
I don't think so, but that would have been
cool. Music starts playing.
My Little Pony. I used to wonder what friendship could. My Little Pony.
No, that's as the credits are rolling. The episode credits.
Oh, man. As these creepy eyes are on the other side and stuff like that.
My Little Pony.
The actual ending now.
Yes. Sign us off, guys.
This has been Fallout is Dragons.
Join us next week when we kill another dragon, maybe.